You're now watching Pastor Pollock, pastor of St. John's Lutheran Church, seated at the front. This is our first Lenten service after Ash Wednesday. And this is March the 8th, 2017. We're in the process of Lent. Started with Ash Wednesday and we'll end with Easter. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. We have Lenten services every Wednesday, and we're studying different words that have to do with our faith. Tonight, we're also studying the books of the Bible, and we're studying the Word, based on John, 1 John 1-3, Hebrews 1-1-2, and Pastor is going to explain what we mean by the Gospel of the Word this evening. Can see our altar. Pastor Pollock, pastor of St. John's Lutheran Church, we're at the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia, Springfield, Ohio. We invite you to come to our services.
Before we begin our worship service this evening, we had a discussion downstairs that I wanted to share with you to see your opinion. That is, we are wondering if we have moved everything back too early. That if it would work better if we had supper at 5:30 and then worship at 7, because it seems like ever since 2 years ago we moved to 5, we have fewer people at supper than normal. And like last week with Ash Wednesday, starting at 6:30 for Ash Wednesday, we had our lowest attendance for Ash Wednesday, even when we've had inclement weather. So the thought is that beginning next week, we would have supper at 5:30, worship at 7, and then when Holy Week comes, Monday, Thursday, and Good Friday would both be at 7 o'clock as well. So what say you? Think? Of course, next week, also remember, next week it won't be 6:30 this time, it will be 7:30, thanks to losing our sleep this Saturday. So anybody have any strong opinion one way or the other?
I like 5:30 because of my work schedule.
5:30? Okay.
Works better a little later for me too.
5:30.
Yeah. That's what you think. A lot of people are going to work till 5 o'clock, so that really puts you to rest. So, okay, beginning next week, we'll have supper from 5:30 to 6:30, 6:45, and then have worship at 7. So this evening we begin with Almighty God, your word is cast, hymn number 516, in the back of your red worship.
Studying the Word of God. It's written by John Caywood, C-A-W-O-O-D, who lived 1775 to 1852. Almighty God, your word is cast.
Thank you.
correction, and teach us to reflect it in our lives. Grant this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Our reading for this evening is from the first chapter of the Apostle's letter to the Hebrews. The Apostle writes, "Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
In a reading of the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the first chapter, glory to you, O Lord. St. John writes, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. We will now sing hymn number 325 in the back of your worship book, "I Want to Walk with Jesus." Hymn number 325.
African-American spiritual, "I Want to Walk with Jesus." It's for Lent. It's written a plantation song and was brought to popularity in the late 1800s.
First page says the word, John 1:1-14, Hebrews 1:1-2. This first page basically works like our sermon notes do on Sunday. The other pages will be self-explanatory as we come to them. So grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. When a plane takes off, it needs a control tower. Because the control tower can see what the pilots cannot. The pilots have a limited vantage point. They can't see what's underneath them. They can't see what's above them. Even with all their instruments, they cannot see all the weather conditions that will affect their flight plans. So the folks in the control tower provide the pilots with information they wouldn't have because of their limited vantage point. The Word of God is a control tower for the Christian life. Where we have only a limited vantage point of God and what God has revealed to us, His Word communicates to us what is going on in the spiritual realm that we cannot see. So, what is the Word? What do we mean when we talk about the Word? What do we mean when we talk about, well, my Bible says? What do we mean when we talk about a translation? And what is the difference in translations of God's Word? We hear God's Word in the Bible, and we see God's Word in the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ. From the beginning, God has been determined to communicate with us, to tell us, this is who I am. God first spoke in the swirling chaos of creation and the world that came into being, revealing that our God is a God of order and nurture. Scientists, even those who claim no belief in a supreme being, have to admit that there are certain laws of nature, and that as human beings upon this earth, we cannot violate those laws of nature without there being extreme consequences. And we have seen what has happened when we have tried to violate the laws of nature, or when we've done them by accident. So God is a God of order and nurture. He nurtures us with a creation that provides us with food and clothing, home and family, and all we need from day to day. He did not just create the world and then disappear, but instead He nurtures us not only with what He created, but He nurtures us with His Word. He nurtures us with the written Word, which we refer to as Holy Scripture. And He nurtures us with the living Word, our Lord Jesus Christ. So what we see is also that God is not a God of wrath, a picture of God that is often made. There are those who think of God only as a God of wrath because they only see God in nature. When you study ancient history and you look at the religions of pagan peoples, you oftentimes see a religion based on the forces of nature or some aspect of the created world. They worship the sun or the moon or the stars, or they worship a volcano, or they worship something else peculiar to where they live. And because of that is their basis, they think that God is a God of wrath who constantly has to be appeased. A God who constantly has to be made happy so that He does not bring destruction down upon them through one of these natural aspects of creation that they believe in. And so God is a God of order and nurture, not a God of wrath. Throughout history, God's Word has been heard on the lips of people who have reminded us as well that our God is a God of justice and mercy. again, when we look at pagan religions, when we look at some of the religions of the world, we see a God who is not a God of justice and mercy, but a God of wrath, a God of judgment, a God who seems to have no love for the people that he supposedly created, a God that seems to almost take pleasure in harming the people he's created. And then the living word Jesus Christ shows us God's ultimate word of forgiveness and reconciliation, which is God's grace. That which we spoke about on Ash Wednesday. God's grace. That love for us that is undeserved. Jesus Christ is the living word, which shows us that forgiveness, reconciliation, and grace. So this counteracts that idea of God as a God of wrath. I can remember one Sunday afternoon, it was a beautiful fall afternoon on my grandmother's farm. I was about fourth grade, my little sister would have been first grade, my older sister would have been seventh grade. My little sister and I were in the front yard raking leaves. And suddenly, after we'd been doing this for about a half hour, so my older sister came out and she started yelling at my little sister and telling us how we had to run and put our rakes up as quickly as possible so that hopefully God didn't see us raking the leaves, because after all it was Sunday and we were doing work on Sunday and therefore violating the third commandment. And heaven help us what God might do to us for raking leaves on Sunday. Of course, that was a misconception of God. None of us at that age had gone through confirmation. My older sister was just starting confirmation and had not learned yet that our God is not a God of wrath, but a God of justice and mercy, of forgiveness and reconciliation, and a God of grace. So what does this all mean? Well, the words of the Bible point us to the Word of Jesus Christ. Jesus is the living Word. He is God in action. As the writer of that first chapter of the letter to the Hebrews said in our first reading, long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. So long ago, at many times and many ways, the word many ways literally means many separate revelations. That long ago, in other words, the old covenant, God gave separate revelations over the centuries. He spoke to Adam and Eve. He spoke to Noah. He spoke to Abraham. He spoke to Jacob, he spoke to Joseph, spoke to Moses, he then spoke to Joshua, and then we have the period of the judges, and he spoke to different judges to rescue the Hebrew children, and then they formed a nation, and first had King Saul, and David, and then Solomon, and then the country was split apart after Solomon's son took over, and then we had God making revelations to the prophets. So all these were separate revelations. And that's what he means by long ago and many times in many ways. And when he says God spoke to our fathers, this word spoke has an interesting meaning. Because it doesn't just mean to make an utterance or to be talking. It means to speak instead of just being. What do I mean by that? Again, we have to go back to world religion and pagan religion, where we often see a God who has no communication with those who follow him. There is the original rules and regulations he gave them, the original laws that he gave them to follow it, and since then, that God has done nothing. And it's up to the people to try to reach him, it's up to the people to try to please him, and try to please him enough so that he will let them into paradise, or heaven, or nirvana, or whatever they call it. Well, what the writer of the Hebrews is telling us is that God, the true God, isn't just there, but that he speaks to us. And in these last times, he came to speak to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. And that through his Son, we see God revealed. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed means to ordain, the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. So Jesus was not just Jesus of Nazareth walking the earth in the first century AD, but he was actually the spoken word of God at creation, and there at creation. And as the gospel lesson tells us, becomes flesh. So the writer to the Hebrews is emphasizing to us that God communicated to us by prophets, and then when the time was right, sent his son to speak to us and to reveal God completely to us, or to reveal God as completely as God wanted us to know him at this time. Where we see God revealed in Jesus Christ, there are some things that Jesus didn't quite reveal to us. Although he speaks quite often about heaven, although he speaks quite often about the kingdom, although he often used parables to say the kingdom of heaven is like, he didn't really give us a full insight into what heaven is like. And so that's why you hear people ask questions such as, are there golf courses in heaven? And you always shoot a perfect score if you're a golfer or if you're a fisherman. Are there lakes in heaven? Are they always filled with fish so that every time you throw your line in, immediately you hit a trophy-sized fish? Or are there ice cream parlor on every corner where you can go in and eat the biggest sundae or banana split you want, you don't gain a pound? We don't know. And Jesus didn't get that specific. What he revealed was everything God wanted us to know as we continue our pilgrimage on earth. And that's what Jesus did. And so this Jesus who revealed God as he lived among us in the flesh is the same Jesus who is at creation. As St. John tells us in our gospel lesson for this evening, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And then he goes on to say, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we've seen his glory. Glory as the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So as we read the Word, the written Word, we come face to face with God, and we meet God in the form of his Son, Jesus Christ, and because of his Son, Jesus Christ, is the center of the Word, when we talk about the Word with a capital W. So Jesus is the center of the Word, and being the center of the Word, the Bible then has authority over all things. For us as Christians, the Bible is the ultimate authority. We appeal to the Bible for all questions about life. In the Bible, we are told to be a good citizen. But in the Bible, we're also told that if our government wants us to do something contrary to God's will, then we are to obey God rather than people. But otherwise, we are to be a good citizen. So the Bible is the ultimate authority for those of us who claim Jesus Christ as Lord. God speaks to us through the Bible, not so we may believe that Jesus is the Christ, but so that we may believe in Jesus the Christ. So what we're saying here is that God speaks to us through the Word to convince us not to believe that this Jesus of Nazareth is Jesus the Christ and have head knowledge about it, but instead he speaks to us so that we will believe in Jesus Christ. And that's what's important. When we talk about the Word, it is important that we do not forget what the Word points us to, and that is Jesus Christ. The Word does not point us to a bunch of rules and regulations. The Word does not point us to certain ideas that sometimes people try to claim are in the Word and twist them for our own gain, whether it be political or financial or advantage in the community or whatever. We believe is that sometimes denominations take something about the word too far. And what you end up having happening is that they're not actually worshiping Jesus Christ anymore. They're worshiping a translation. There is a denomination that comes out of the fundamentalist tradition that believes the King James Version of the Bible is the only version of the Bible that you can read. They do not allow any other translation in their churches. They do not allow their people to read any other translation but the King James Version. They are so insistent upon it that even the churches, you'll know if you're going by one of their churches because they'll have an awning out front above their front door or a porch or some type of awning, and it will show a Bible, and an open Bible, say 1670, and it'll say AV, Authorized Version, or King James Version. Now the problem with this kind of mentality is that even though the King James Version is the most beautiful translation in English that we have, the problem is there are at least today 800 words in the King James Version of the Bible that have a totally different meaning in English today than they did in 1670. And if you read the King James Version of the Bible, not only this, and you come to one of these words that have changed their meaning in our day, and you read it the way we understand the word, then that's going to totally throw a totally different light on that verse. For an example, the word apology. When we use the word apology, we mean that we are telling someone we're sorry for something we've done. We're sorry we made a mistake, we're sorry we raised our voice at them, we're sorry we blamed them for something they didn't do. It's an act of contrition, it's an act of attempted reconciliation. It's an act of acknowledging a fault. Now back in the 15th, 16th, and 17th centuries, the word apology had a totally different meaning. In the Lutheran Church, the main document that describes the Lutheran Church is something called the Augsburg Confession that was written and presented to the Pope and to the Holy Roman Emperor in order to explain why Luther and his followers were saying there should be reforms in the church and these are what they should be. So the emperor and the Pope and his representative read the Augsburg Confession and then sent it back with a bunch of questions to further explain certain areas. And so a second work was done, and this was called the Apology to the Augsburg Confession. Well, when I first went to seminary and saw that, I thought, why are we apologizing for something we wrote and claimed to be a true explanation of the faith? Well, it was when I got in the confessions class that I learned, and that was the first time I had ever heard this, that back then the word apology meant in defense of something. So if you were apologizing, you were standing up and defending something. So imagine you're reading the King James Version of the Bible in 2017, and you come across the word apology, and you think of it as meaning recanting or saying you're sorry or trying to reconcile, and it means in defense of. You're totally going to misconstrue what that verse is saying. So the problem is some people get so emotional about this that what they're actually doing is worshiping the translation and not worshiping Jesus. One of these churches had a guest pastor one Sunday. And as the pastor was introduced, he came up to the pulpit. And if you've ever been in a fundamentalist church, usually they have a platform and there's a pulpit right in the middle. They don't have an altar, they don't have a pulpit, a lectern, they just have a stand right in the middle, and that's where the priest comes from. Some are ornate and fancy, some aren't much more than this music stand that I'm using. So he goes up to the pulpit. There's this beautiful King James Version of the Bible lying on that pulpit. And he says, "Good morning, ladies and gentlemen." He picks up that King James Version of the Bible and throws it out the window. And as he throws it out the window, he points to him and says, "There goes your God." So the word is not the translation you carry to church on Sunday. The word is not the translation you have by your bedside. Your translation is a translation. This is where I need you now to turn to the second page of what I gave you. See, the Bible, as Luke described it, he said, the Bible is the cradle in which the baby Jesus lay. We worship the baby Jesus, not the cradle. But if you're thinking one translation is superior to all others, you're worshiping the cradle and not the baby. All right. How many books are in the Bible?
66.
How many are in the Old Testament? Without looking, how many are in the Old Testament?
39.
If you cannot remember 39, what's a simple way you can find the answer to how many books are in the Old Testament? I'm not cheating you on this. Very good, Jen. Three letters Old, nine letters Testament, 39. Now, how do you figure out how many are in the New Testament? Same thing, 3 and 9. They're not 39 books in the New Testament.
3 times 9.
What? How do you figure it out? You take the cross of Christ, put it between Old and New. 3 times 9 is 27. 39 and 27 is 66. That's what I teach all my confirmants. If you want to get it right on the test, just remember. Old Testament is just spelling out the letters, 3 and 9. When it comes to the New Testament, you have to multiply, put the cross of Christ on in, kind of tilt sideways, so it becomes a multiplication sign. 3 times 9 is 27. Okay, now, who can tell me what this means? How many, or maybe you've seen this, a big 6, and then to the left of the 6 at the top, there's a 1. Underneath that's a 3, and underneath that's a 6. So it says 16, 36, 66. Anybody know what the 16 means? Now there's some people in here I thought for sure would know. Some of you that grew up doing the sword drill, they like, come on. 16 centuries from the book of Genesis to writing the book of Revelation. 36 writers, 36 different writers of the 66 books. And then, of course, the 66 stands for the 66 books of the Bible. Now, some modern-day scholars are saying there are actually more than 36 writers, but historically, that's what we see. And what is so unique about that is that you have 16 centuries of 36 different people writing, and yet they all write the same message. They all tell us the same thing. The plan of salvation does not veer from Genesis to Revelation. Again, Martin Luther said that the book of Genesis had more gospel in it than the book of James, which is the New Testament epistle. So just because something's in the Old Testament does not mean there's not any gospel. There's a lot of places where it's talking about the coming of Jesus, or there are people who are like foreshadows of Jesus and what Jesus would do. One of those is Joseph. Joseph is a foreshadow of Jesus. If you remember the story of Joseph. And his brothers hate him, throw him into a pit, sell him into slavery, and says life's dead. His father thinks he resurrects to a new life in Egypt. Coming the second most powerful person only to Pharaoh. So, sticking to that page, you see that Old Testament, 5 books of law, 12 history, 5 poetry, 5 major prophets, 12 minor prophets, Major night of prophets, it does not, that does not mean that five major prophets are more important than the 12 minor. It simply means the size of the book. The five major prophets, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, and Daniel, all are books of over 40 chapters long. Isaiah 60-something, 66 or so. The minor prophets are all books that don't have more than 12 chapters. Some of them only a chapter or two. But in some of the minor prophet books, that we have some of the clearest prophecies about Jesus. The book of Zechariah, we have the prophecy of Palm Sunday, that the Messiah would enter Jerusalem on a colt that had never been ridden. In the New Testament, we have four Gospels, one history, 13 Pauline epistles, 8 general epistles, and 1 book of prophecy, Revelation. For the Jewish people, the 5 books of the law are like the 4 Gospels are for us. Every synagogue service, the law has to be read. They don't have to read prophets or the wisdom, literature, or poetry, as it's called. But they have to read the law. Like in the type of church tradition we come from, it's always important to read the gospel. You don't have to read the epistle or the Old Testament lesson or the Cygnus song or read the psalm each week, but you have to do the gospel because that tells us about Jesus our Savior. There then you have how all books are supposed to be pronounced, although it varies in part of the country you're from. All right, next page. This is the example of if you open the scroll in the synagogue, you are handed the scroll of the law, and you open it to its very first portion. This is the first chapter of Genesis as it is written in Hebrew. However, on the scroll, you would not have the numbers or the English translation. You would just have the Hebrew letter. Hebrew, unlike English, is read not from left to right, but right to left. So when you're studying Hebrew and Greek at the same time, it's a real challenge. Because Greek is like English, you're going left to right, then you turn around and you go to Hebrew and you gotta go right to left. Your brain's gotta remember to shift gears so that you know what you're doing. This is what the word, Old Testament word, is originally written in, Hebrew. And in Hebrew, a lot of times, the vowels are a notation over the letters. Hebrew is written in all consonants. These are all consonants you see. Above the letters or between the letters, you see some little markings. Those are what tell you the vowels. So you have to really know your Hebrew to be able to read it. And so that's what the Old Testament's written in. Turn the page. Who wants to tell me what the big bold print says across the top? So guess what that says. Gets a content.
God is the word at the end.
circle with a line in the middle of it, E-O-V. Actually, it's an N, so it's theon, word for God, theon, theon. So that is what the New Testament is written in. That is the Word of God. What we carry is a translation. Y'all remember Joyce, little girl from Whitburg we had a couple years ago. I can't remember her last name, it began with a P. But she was here for 2 years helping.
Hardigan.
Yeah, there you go, Hardigan, Joyce. Before her was Becca, the agent. Becca went to seminary up in Chicago, the Lutheran Seminary in Chicago, so I didn't get to have much interaction with her. But Joyce went to Columbus, so I got to, especially her first year or two, I kept in touch with her. And I remember when she had to study Greek, and she told me how she got a totally different understanding of the New Testament once she was reading it in Greek, in the original, instead of an English translation. And how some translations were so poor in actually translating what really is said in the Greek. So when we talk about the Word, we mean the original Word as the writers wrote it down from the Holy Spirit, written in Hebrew and Greek. Again, as I said, we have translations. What you have to concern yourself about with translations, if you look at the front of it and it says list of translators and it's only a couple of people and they're all from the same denomination, you don't want to buy that one because it's going to be biased. If you get a Bible and like the ESV, which I use, New American Standard, you'll see page after page of translators, and they're from every denomination, liturgical denominations, Baptist denominations, Pentecostal denominations. So scholars from all denominations got together to try to make the most accurate translation without putting denominational bias in it. So you may remember back in the 80s, there was a real popular version of the Bible called the Living Bible. Well, first of all, the Living Bible wasn't a translation. It was a paraphrase. So you were not getting an accurate word-for-word translation of the Hebrew and Greek. You were getting a paraphrase. Since then, they have come out with the New Living Translation, which is an actual translation, and it is pretty good. It's pretty accurate. But what we have are translations. When you have the Greek and Hebrew, you have the Word as it was originally handed down to the writers. Now, anybody want to give me an explanation as why the New Testament is written in Greek and not in Latin, since Rome was a ruling empire at the time that the books of the New Testament were written? Anybody have a clue to that?
Well, in Greek, St. Peter, when they first started, you know, evangelizing, they go to the Greeks. I kind of think they went to the Greeks first.
Okay, what?
Went to the Greeks first when they started to start writing the Bible.
I think you're on the right track.
The first people were evangelized with the Greeks, I'm thinking. Maybe I'm wrong.
Okay. They spoke Greek, but my question is, why were they speaking Greek instead of Latin, which was the Roman Empire's language? When Jesus went before Pilate, Latin was spoken, because that was the language of the Roman judicial system.
Alexander brought Grecian culture.
Pardon?
Alexander brought Grecian culture.
Okay, Dr. Confucius is on the right track. When Alexander the Great conquered the Middle East, he was in love with Greek culture. Even though he was a Macedonian, he loved everything Greek. He forced Greek on everybody he conquered. He made them speak Greek. He made them adopt Greek architecture, a Greek philosophy. When he died, his two generals, Seleucus and Ptolemy, divided the empire, and they continued to enforce this idea. This is why we have, toward the close of the Old Testament, period. The Maccabean Revolt, because the Greeks tried to make them put up a statue of Jupiter in the temple and sacrifice a hog to Zeus. Of course, that was against Jewish law. But when Rome then took over, you had all these people already speaking Greek. So it made no sense to say, okay, now you gotta speak Latin. So they saved Latin for their official business, their politics, their judicial system, but commerce especially, trade, spoke Greek. So when the evangelists and the writers of the epistles were inspired by the Holy Spirit to write their books of the New Testament, the Holy Spirit directed them to write in Greek, because no matter where they went, someone would be able to read it, and they would understand it. See, and this is one thing that we kind of have done in disservice to Peter, James, and John, and Andrew. We always talk about, you know, simple fishermen, and kind of yahoos living out in Galilee. They had to be smart men, because they had to know Greek and Hebrew both. To sell their fish, they had to be able to speak Greek, because Galilee was becoming so Gentile. So many Gentiles moving in that spoke Greek, they wouldn't be able to do business just speaking Hebrew. And so this is why the New Testament is in Greek. It was basically the universal language at the time, even though Rome was a much bigger empire than Alexander the Great ever had. This Greek idea of Alexander's held on. And so even Romans would have Greek teachers teach their children, and Greek philosophers teach their children. So that's why the New Testament is put in Greek. It's like today, almost anywhere you go, you can speak English, and somebody's going to know English. They may not speak it really well, but they know it enough to get by. You know, I've been told, and maybe some of you have been there and can verify, but I've been told, like, you go to France, and almost every Frenchman knows English, but they won't let you know it, because they want you to speak French. And so they'll act like they don't know English, but they do, but they don't want to submit to Americans that speak our language. But, you know, you go to Russia, you go to China, you go to Japan, anywhere almost that we do business, and people speak English. So that's why the New Testament was written in Greek. So to bring this to a close, because we're gone here and I realized I would, the Bible verses you have. I've got a print earlier, so I'm not going to read them. I'm just going to tell you what they said, or a rough answer which you should put. Why did God give us a Bible? Psalm 119, to show us a light to walk through life, to lighten the path for us to walk in life. Something to that nature should be given. Luke 11, I gave us a Bible to be a guide for life, to live by and to follow. Blessed and rare those who hear the word of God and do it. Romans, here the word was given to us so we would know the way of salvation, and that salvation is by grace through faith, not by anything we do. And then the long passage there from 2 Timothy, God gave us his word for training, to strengthen our faith, to trust in Jesus Christ, to realize that these are not ordinary words, but words inspired by God, by the Holy Spirit, and to see that we are equipped for serving Christ and the church. So, just as I mentioned at the beginning, that a pilot needs a control tower in order to give them information that they cannot receive otherwise, we need the word to provide for us that valuable information we need in living our pilgrimage on earth, that important information concerning God and who he really is, concerning our Savior Jesus Christ, concerning faith and the plan of salvation. So the word is needed every day in our lives. Amen. any blank needs to be filled in that you didn't get the answer for?
Yeah, what was the first two blanks on number five? I heard God's flesh at the end, but I didn't catch the first two blanks.
Questions one and two, or
five.
Two and three?
Five.
Oh, question five. In Jesus Christ, we hear God's ultimate word.
Forgiveness.
What was it?
Yeah.
Forgiveness.
We find God's ultimate word of forgiveness and reconciliation, God's grace. Anything else?
I just had a question about the origins of the names Old Testament and New Testament.
Where those came from? From the church to separate the Old Covenant, the Old Testament or Old Covenant was what God made with the Jewish people at Sinai. And then when Jesus came along, the New Covenant with the church. Of course, in Judaism, they don't call the Old Testament or the Old Covenant. For them, it's the law and the prophets. It's been given to them. It's the church that made it as a nation. Anyone else?
I've got another question I'd like to bring up. What I'm thinking, and I should have thought of it. Greek philosophers, and they had what I want to try to say is, they was open-minded to different religions. Correct me if I'm wrong on that. Different ideas. They were open to different ideas. When they come along, when Christianity come along, they, you know, I don't know if they accepted it or not, but they opened their mind up to the different beliefs.
You talk about the Greeks?
Yeah, the Greeks. Yeah. That's what I'm thinking about. I don't know what I was thinking about. That's what I think.
Yeah,
about.
They were always searching for more knowledge.
Yeah.
And like when we studied in Acts when Paul went to Athens and they had the mm-hmm. altar to the unknown God.
Yeah.
Figured there was
that's
somebody
what I'm talking
out there.
About, St. Paul.
Yeah.
That's what made me think of it.
Right. Anybody else? If I could have two volunteers for the offering. Anybody? Doesn't matter.
Time for our offering. This is March the 8th, 2017, our first Wednesday service. We studied the Word tonight, and Pastor Pollock went over a quick synopsis of the entire Bible, 66 books of the Bible. The Old Testament was written in Hebrew, and the New Testament written in Greek, and he explained all this to us, and different translations, and that we should read more than one translation if we have trouble understanding the Bible and not just stick to one, because it may be biased and may not be a good translation. Pastor has read it, of course, in Greek and understands it very thoroughly. And the Jewish people have their scrolls in Hebrew, understand it very thoroughly. We can learn from them. He invites you to watch us during Lent, the pillars of Lent, fasting and prayer and almsgiving.
Should have mentioned next week, law and gospel. Another one of the highly disputed terms during the Reformation. What is law and gospel? So that'll be next week. Let us pray. O Almighty God, Heavenly Father, who did not appoint us who confess the name of your who did appoint us who confess the name of your Son to preach his death until he comes again. We come before you in your throne of grace, humbly trusting in your mercy. We thank you that you have given us a high priest, even Jesus Christ, who knows our infirmities, having borne them, who understands our temptations, having endured them, and who learned obedience by the things which he suffered. O Lamb of God, fill us with a true love for you, so that all fear of holy submission to your word is overcome. Grant us such trust that we, hearkening to your voice, may find the true joy of conforming our wills to your holy will. O Holy Spirit, If we are led into the wilderness of temptation, deliver us by your power and save us from all evil. Help us to wrestle daily against the powers of darkness. Overthrow the tempter Satan and every assault on our souls. Make us strong in you, and by the example of the Lord Jesus, show us the victorious power of your holy word. Let your blessings rest upon our homes. Give all parents wisdom to see the influence of character and grace, to be true followers of him who is the light of the world, so that by their manner of life and conversation, they may be worthy lights unto their children. Dear Father, if any among us be afflicted with suffering and pain, grant that we may learn of your love and receive your fatherly chastity. If any be sorrowful, give them the comfort of your promises. If any be in need, show yourself the source of all good. If any be dying, give them the confidence that though the earthly house of this tabernacle be dissolved, we have a building of God eternal in the heavens. Now, O Father, give your angels charge over all your people to minister to their salvation and to bring us safely through this world to that eternal kingdom which you have prepared for all of us that love you. In the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior and Lord, who has taught us to say when we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May the almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless, comfort, strengthen, and keep us, now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude this evening's service with God's Word, Our Great Heritage, in 509, in the back of your worship. In number 509, remember next week, supper at 5:30, church at 7.
Very short hymn, God's Word is Our Great Heritage, written by Nikolai Grundig, 1783 to 1872. This goes along with the theme of our service tonight, the Word of God. For watching our midweek Lenten service, March 8th, 2017, on YouTube. We invite you to worship with us at 8 o'clock every Sunday or at 10:30 every Sunday. It's Sunday school at 9:15. St. John's Lutheran Church, the corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. Springfield, Ohio. Our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. We've heard him this evening give his sermon on the Word, and next week is the Law and Gospel. Next week we'll have the supper at 5:30, preceding the service at 7 o'clock. We'll have services all during Lent every Wednesday as we're studying and learning about the Bible and the words that we are using in our faith, learning more about our faith, getting closer to God, closer to Jesus Christ. We invite you to come join us, receive the true body and true blood of Jesus Christ in Holy Communion. We invite you to come any Sunday, come Wednesday during Lent. We also have Wednesday services, not during Lent, at 6:30. We receive Holy Communion every Wednesday in the chapel. Thank you for watching our service on YouTube. We invite you to come worship with us.